Today we're going to talk about a question. Do you fall in love with your business? Do you fall in love with your clients? Who do you fall in love with? Okay, an attendee at one of our masterminds once said, "Jay, I love my business. It's the clients I hate." Well, the Chinese have a proverb that says, "He who cannot smile should not keep shop." Unless and until you learn to fall in love with your clients, you can never really love being in your business. Today, we're going to explore and understand not only why that's necessary, because that's the hard part, but the joyous part is why it makes the process of living the rest of your business life so enjoyable, so fulfilling, so connective, and so richly and wildly rewarding. Most people in business, and I'm afraid most people who are in the information and the speaking and the authoring and the advising business, they fall in love with their expertise, or they fall in love with their own company, or they fall in love with their ideology or their methodology. And that's okay, but it's limiting. The key, if you want to practice the strategy of preeminence, is you fall in love with your client. You live for the betterment. You live for the impact. You live for the improvement. You live for the liberation. You live for the transformation you really can and will make in their lives. Next, you do not wait for money to change hands before you contribute. It's only a matter of time. The right people will work with you if you've got the right strategy. So you give. But you don't give promiscuously, you give strategically. And you got to learn strategy. And most people, unfortunately, are very tactical. And that's a whole different discussion, which I'll see if I can get into later. But the strategy of preeminence has a bunch of different parts of it. A couple of other key elements. I said you have a moral obligation. One of the things is every time you come into your, you deal with them as a client, not as a customer. And there's a reason for it. If you want to be seen as their most trusted advisor and you realize that it's more of a fiduciary responsibility and you know that there's 9 million generic competitors out there wanting to be you just like there's 2,000 wanting to be me, you gotta draw a line in the sand and say, I'm not going to play the game and concede commodity status. Well, if you look at Webster's Dictionary's definition of a customer, it's somebody who buys a commodity or a service. If you call somebody a customer, subconsciously, implicitly, you're saying, hey, I'm just a commodity. If you look at their definition of client, it's somebody under the care, the well-being, the protection of another, and that's the stature. Whether you call them that or not, you need to think that. So if they're going to be your client, you want to make sure that every time you interact with them, their life is better off because you were in it for that period of time, whether it's a conversation. And it's a transactional belief system that should transcend just your business. I mean, when I'm in the lobbies, I try to smile at the housekeepers and the janitors because you want to make their life better. You want to make them feel special, and that's it. You want them to know they are special to you. You feel what they feel, and you got to have a hopefulness for a better tomorrow. And the way to demonstrate that is to practice, I guess they call it future pacing, taking them into the future and showing them what it's going to be like and letting them feel and savor and experience vicariously the transformation that together you're going to be achieving. And I can go on and on, but first thing I do is maximize what you're doing. Next thing I do is multiply the options. And as I'm doing that, I instill and install this strategy of preeminence, much more. As I said, if you want it, I'll be glad to send it to you or give you a DVD. It's no big deal.